Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to promote and strengthen traditional marriage. I encourage you to sign up for our free e-newsletter at the website, which has information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Here at Ruth, we've just finished our annual student conference, It Takes a Family to Raise a Village. This is Dr. Robert Gagnon's second lecture, Paul and Homosexual Practice. He takes questions afterward, too.
Dr. Gagnon is going to talk for 45 minutes. Now, you see we have a clock back there for you. Can you see that? Can you see that? When the big
hand... What's a clock?
Yeah, that's what it's afraid of. Okay, so when the big
hand... It's very shiny, very nice.
...is on the five... Yes. When the big... Mickey's big hand is on the five, you have to stop, okay? Take questions.
I have no idea what you're talking about. But... All right, so I heard Jennifer say, take as much time as you need. That was what I... That's what I heard. I don't know. Some things just don't register. Let's pray. I ask you, Lord, that you be present in our midst and you guide and direct us, that your word, Lord, would be powerful, that the presence of your spirit would move in our hearts. And you change the way, Lord, that we think about ourselves and about you and our place in the world in which you've created. Thank you, Lord, that you have renewed our minds and continue to do so. There's truly nobody greater than you. We bow before you and acknowledge you to be Lord of all. In the name of your Son, we pray. Amen. Okay, so today we're going to talk about Paul's witness on the issue. Now, Paul has basically become a whipping boy for this whole discussion. And Paul is sort of the enemy. And Jesus is fine, but Paul distorts everything. Actually, as we saw last time, Jesus' view is, I was going to say, very much in line with Paul's, but of course it's the reverse. Paul's view is very much in line with Jesus's. There's no disagreement between the two. And in fact, last time when we noted that Jesus had pinpointed two primary texts that were normative with prescriptive implications for all matters of human sexual ethics. Let's see if you were paying attention. What two texts were those? Genesis 1:27. Very good. Which is male?
Female.
And very good. And Genesis 2:24. Ah, I gave it. Duh.
Yeah.
Okay. And which is, for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and become joined to his woman or wife, and the two will become. Okay. Good. I love this group. All right, this is a great selection, too. I really appreciate already at your age to be so committed to the principles of the Lord on a very controversial issue. So a great witness to society. Look forward to seeing many good things from all of you in decades to come, if I make it that long. Anyway, Paul. So our main texts are going to be Romans 1, and who knows how much or whether we'll even get much to 1 Corinthians 6:9, and I doubt much of anything in 1 Timothy 1:10. Main text is Romans 1:24-1:27. Again, this is all the GSV, the Gagnon Standard Version translation. Therefore, God gave them over because of the desires of their hearts. Now, the basic context for this, we're going to see Romans 1:18 and following, is human beings suppressing the truth about God accessible to them in the material structures of creation. And it's not just that all people sin. Duh. I mean, that's obvious, right? If you're married, ask your spouse. They'll let you know if you've forgotten that point. Otherwise, ask your parents, and they can let you know. We all sin. That's an easy point. What Paul is trying to demonstrate in 1:18-3:20 of Romans is that all not only sin, but deliberately suppress the truth about God accessible to them. Okay? So it's not that they sin and don't know. It's that they know and sin anyway. Right? Story of all our lives. And because they exchanged the true God for a lie, for a God of their own creation and making, rather than being made, accepting the fact that they are made in God's image, human beings seek to make God in their image. And that's the genesis of idolatry, right? Basically, taking our conception of God, regarding God basically as a cipher for whatever imputed meaning we want to send in that direction. Basically, our own ideology ultimately becomes God. And because human beings do not acknowledge God as God and glorify Him as such, which is the chief overriding sin, singular, out of which all individual sins then become manifested, God does something to them. He hands people over. He gives people over to their pre-existing desires to be enslaved and controlled by the very desires they want to engage in. So in effect, God says, "This is you want to replace me with these desires. Fine. I will step back." Okay, that's the illustration. Much easier than falling on the floor. I will step back. It's as my wife refers to it, as the passive-aggressive mode of God, right? Working in psychology. Passive-aggressive. God doesn't immediately shoot us down with the lightning bolt and incinerate us. Instead, God steps back and allows people to be controlled by those pre-existing desires to do what God has forbidden them to do, and which essentially dishonors or degrades the person that has been made in God's image. So rather than accepting the fact that God has honored us by making us in God's image, we decide that is not good enough. We would prefer to make God in our image, and then in the end up dishonoring and degrading ourselves. That's not a pretty story. To hands them over to an uncleanness, akathisia, sexual impurity, consisting of their bodies being dishonored among themselves. This is literally what the text refers to, dishonoring. The very ones, mind you, who exchanged the truth about God for the lie and worshipped and served the creature rather than the Creator. This is the summary recap of the argument he made in 118 to 123, just preceding this one. So he just reminds the readers of this point. Note the reference here to the creature and the Creator. Because of this, God gave them over to dishonorable passions, for even their females exchanged the natural use. Now, there is no fill-in at that point in the Greek. I have filled in what you see in parentheses is what I think is implied from the context. It just says exchange the natural use. Understood, in my opinion, from the context of the male as regards sexual intercourse. And exchange it for what? For that which is contrary to nature. And likewise also the males, having left the natural behind the natural use of the what? Female. So then you ought to understand here the natural use as of the male. In other words, the natural use, sexually speaking, of the other sex, the sex that you are not. Left behind the natural use of the female, and they were inflamed with their yearning for one another. Scripture regards any desire to do what God expressly forbids and carried out by the individual as necessarily an inflammation, an excessive desire, being controlled by a desire that is not a desire to do what God wants you to do for your life. It exceeds God's wishes for your life, in effect. Males with males committing indecency, and in return receiving in themselves the payback necessitated by this straying from God. So this is all a result or consequence. If you turn from the proper conception of God, there is an inevitable payback that arises from that. Obviously, if you turn from that which is good and right and holy and life-giving, which direction do you think you're headed in? It's not going to be that which is good, holy, righteous, and life-giving. is going to be the opposite of that by definition, and therefore not for your own good. Now, we, of course, do not have to create statues in order to commit idolatry. Simply by creating an image of God in our own mind that is nothing more than a projection of our own individual ideology, our own desires and wants to do whatever we want to do, that is just as much a form of idolatry as actually constructing a statue in the image of humans or animals. So we have really not progressed much from this period of time. We've become a little more subtle about it, perhaps, but no real basic difference. Now, there are three basic arguments that people have used to discount the biblical witness generally and Paul's witness in particular on the issue of homosexual practice. And the first two can be categorized as new knowledge arguments. In other words, we know something that they did not know, and consequently, had they known what we, the Illuminati, now know, right? Because that's really what we are here. I mean, this here again, if you're trying to hold back the sarcasm here, but it's kind of hard. We know better than they did on this point. And if they just get with our program, they will understand. Paul would have understood and certainly would have agreed with us if he knew what he was doing. And one of those points is the exploitation argument. The claim that they knew only exploitative forms of homosexual practice in the ancient world. How am I doing on time, Nori? Pretty good? All right, so far so good. Look, I'm keeping track of things here. All right, so, and the basic exploitative pattern is a man having sex with an adolescent or with a slave or with a call boy. Adolescent, particularly in the Greek period, the Roman period, with a slave or with a call boy. And that's all that they knew about. And had they known about committed, caring homosexual relationships, it might have made, not only they assume might have made a difference, it most certainly would have made a difference, and then Paul would have agreed with us. The orientation argument, which is the argument, as you could imagine, simply that they had no conception of innate influences on homosexual development or any exclusivity in such attractions. And had they had such a view of things, they would have changed their point of view. Those two are the new knowledge arguments. Now, very few scholars who are actually experts in the field on either direction will go with either of those two arguments for reasons we will see in a moment. Although these are still the two main arguments in the church. So basically the church, most of the people who are pushing the case for acceptance of homosexual unions are making it on the basis of the exploitation and orientation arguments in conjunction. Okay? The misogyny argument is the argument that most scholars who want to support homosexual practice gravitate towards. And the argument being made there is that homosexual practice is wrong because it upsets the neat hierarchical balance, hierarchical authority of men over women. And this is, of course, viewed from their perspective in a very negative fashion, where men suppress women and are both literally and figuratively, have to be both literally and figuratively on top of the woman in every sense. So if you have a homosexual relationship, then one of the men is going to have to be on the bottom. If you have a lesbian relationship, one of the women is going to have to be on the top. In other words, the man's going to have to be in subjection. One of the men, one of the women will be in authority. And that just implodes the whole hierarchical structural relationship between man and woman, which they regard as oppressive and exploitative. Now, that argument is different from the other two arguments. The other arguments say basically Paul really didn't absolutely indict homosexual practice. He only indicted exploitative forms and forms in which individuals had the choice of such attraction, not a form that would be committed and caring, engaged in, entered into by persons who are naturally oriented in this direction. The third argument accepts the fact that Paul's indictment is absolute, but it's because Paul's a misogynist. And had Paul not been a woman hater, then things would be different. Okay? Now, the plot structure of Romans 1:18 and 32 is important to get down. Romans 1:18 and 32 is basically an extended vice or offender list. We have these very frequently in Paul, where Paul will say, for example, in 1 Corinthians 6:9, stop deceiving yourselves. In other words, don't be deceiving yourselves that you can do the following things and get away with it, even if you confess Christ as Lord. A verbal confession, while necessary, must be accompanied by the transformed life. Not that you can merit your way into God's good graces, but that if your faith is genuine, it will necessarily issue in a transformed life. Otherwise, it's a mere intellectual assent to the truth, and nothing more than that. And so then Paul will say, then certain groups of people, the following groups, the idolaters, the sexually immoral, etc., will not inherit the kingdom of God. And it's always 1-2, idolatry and sexual immorality in either placement. Sometimes sexual immorality is put first, usually idolatry put first, and then the other put second. Those are always at the top two, indicating that this is of primary importance for Paul. We know from series of letters that Paul has, because he tells us in Galatians and 1 Thessalonians and in other texts, first things that he gets straight with converts. Number one, no more idolatry. Singular devotion to the one God of Jesus Christ. That's it. After that's down, number two, sexual immorality, sexual purity issues. That's number two on all the things that Paul would need to address to new Gentile converts. That's number two. How often is that number two in our cultural context? Never. Never. I've never seen it. Maybe it happened somewhere sometime, but I have never seen it yet, given that kind of weight and that kind of emphasis. And that's why we're in the situation we are currently in, because people are basically in the church uneducated about the significance of sexual purity for a life of holiness before our Lord Jesus Christ. And we're constantly hearing from the authorities in many mainline denominational structures, thankfully not the Catholic Church, not the LDS, but if you're in Protestant circles and you're not a Baptist or you're not a Pentecostal, you're getting the basic view that we have to adjust and change on this position. In fact, they don't even make the notation of adjusting or changing. They just simply argue sexual purity is not important. More or less, that's the message that's being sent. Stage one in the presentation that Paul gives in Romans 1:18 and 32, God's power and divinity is visibly manifested in creation. Okay? This leaves all individuals without excuse. Even if you don't have access to the direct revelation of Scripture, you are unapologetos. You are without excuse, without defense before God when you stand before God at trial. You cannot say, I did not know. God's power is obvious. His divinity is obvious. And human beings have to suppress that truth in order to avoid its implications. And that's, in fact, what they do, sadly, in stage two, is they suppress this truth and they do something else. They exchange. This language of exchanging appears three times in the text, as does the language of God handing over. Human beings exchange, and as a result of the exchange, God hands them over. Okay? So human beings take the initiative to avoid what is truth. And they exchange the true God for idols. Why? Because it's all about manipulating God to serve our purposes. This is why God reveals as a divine name to Moses, Yahweh, which essentially means, I will be what I will be. Okay, so you just don't tell God. God will tell you, God says, I'll let you know on a need-to-know basis who I am. You are not allowed to manipulate who I am. Stage three is that God's wrath is then manifested in this passive-aggressive stage initially, in which he gives or hands people over to these self-degrading desires, Then some human beings go on to a second step of exchanging. They've already exchanged the true God for a lie. So now it's simply a matter of accommodating the rest of their life to this vertical exchange on a horizontal level. And that exchange takes place on a sexual level in its most extreme manifestation, apart from bestiality, which is regarded as so beyond the pale, outside one's own species, that doesn't even have to be mentioned. But in terms of intra-human relationships, in terms of sexual immorality, the most extreme manifestation that Paul can come up with, because it's the clearest evidence of operating against nature, requiring the greatest degree of suppression of the truth about God accessible in the material structures of creation. Right? It takes a lot of years of education to suppress this truth, that man and woman have been created as sexual counterparts or complements to each other. Because this is intended to be, if we could be a little anachronistic here, it's not rocket science, it's not brain surgery, it is intended to be obvious, such that it requires massive suppression of the truth in order to avoid that reality. And then all, of course not everybody is committing same-sex intercourse, but all commit some form of improper act. So we have filled out the remaining part of the vice list at the very end of the chapter in 128 to 31. That leads to stage four. In other words, it's not just contrary to some erroneous interpretations by some commentators. God does not leave it at that point. God just passive-aggressively steps back and allows you to be enslaved by those pre-existing desires. There is a step when God steps back into the picture, and that is after human beings continue to heap up their sins. It leads ultimately to cataclysmic judgment at the end, death. So you don't want to get to that stage four, okay? So you want to try to avoid that. If you've already reached stage three, you really want to start to push back and get back to the original point. Now, the overarching question we will address is Romans 1:24 to 1:27 opposed only to some forms of homosexual practice, exploitative forms, or is it an absolute indictment of all homosexual relations? Okay? And basically about five major arguments here can be brought to bear. And I want to see if you'll remember them all at the end. Okay? You should be able to reproduce them because you are going to face, in various contexts, persons who will say, the Bible is not really opposed to committed, caring homosexual unions. Right? That's the great argument being used nowadays. And you should be prepared to be able to give a reasonable answer to those who have a reasonable question. Okay? Now, it doesn't mean you're going to convert anybody, even if you can show them this from Scripture. But there are some people who genuinely want to know or are on the fence and not sure which way they should go, and you need to be able to counsel them appropriately. Because it's all a ripple effect. Somebody adopts an erroneous view on this issue, who knows how many other people they then impact in their life with their view. Now, first point to be made is there's a clear allusion to Scripture, to Genesis text, to the creation text here, and in particular Genesis 1. What scholars call intertextual echoes. This is a burgeoning industry of New Testament studies, and it's looking at not only direct citations of Old Testament texts in the New Testament, but looking at indirect allusions to the Old Testament text, where you have to do a little work to uncover it, right? Sort of like a parable. Parable doesn't tell you the answer immediately. You have to do a little creative thinking in regards to the parable to figure out what Jesus is communicating when he tells it. And when you discover it, it has a deeper impact on your life than I've just straightforward told you the answer, right? That's what's going on here with intertextuality. You've got to do a little digging, a little uncovering. But once it becomes evident, then, it has a major, a more significant impact on the hearer. Now, that we are moving in the direction of the creation text should already be suggested to the reader by the clear references to the creation in 120 and the creator in 125. Then there is an echo we see to Genesis 1:26 that we find in Romans 1:23. Catch all the correspondences here. According to Romans 1:23, humans exchange the glory of the imperishable God for the likeness of the image of a perishable human and of birds and of four-footed animals and of reptiles. Okay, look at Genesis 1:26. Let us make a human according to our image and likeness, and let them rule over the birds, the cattle, and the reptiles. How many points of correspondence between these two verses? It's a lot. More specifically, please. Six points of correspondence between these two verses. And we're not done. Now, if we look at Romans 1:26 to 1:27, why is it that Paul repeatedly uses the nomenclature male and female as opposed to using the nomenclature man and woman? Because, as you can see, the very next text of Genesis is male and female, he made them. In other words, the intent is to cite that as the background for the reason for the rejection of homosexual practice. Now, I'm sorry I couldn't put all this in one page and still make it as big as you probably need to see it, but basically we have here in chart form a tripartite structure where A denotes God's likeness and image in humans, and B denotes dominion over the animal kingdom, and C denotes male-female differentiation. On the left, we have Genesis 1:26 to 1:27, and on the right, we have Romans 1:23 and 1:26 to 1:27. And you can see the tripartite structure, and in between, human image and likeness, birds, cattle, reptiles, male, female. Now, there's some inversion of order at the beginning. Human and likeness is inverted in the order in Romans 1:23, and that's because of the secondary intertextual echo to texts in the Psalms where they Israel itself engages in idolatry and exchanges the true God for a golden calf. And that secondary echo has rearranged the order slightly. It's a double intertextual echo, not at all surprising. If you look, for example, when I talk about Greek exegesis in third term of the Greek sequence at Pittsburgh Seminary, we use as the classic text of intertextuality the Last Supper, Jesus' words at the Last Supper. It's just loaded up, no direct citation of any Old Testament text, but loaded up with allusions in a short compass of sayings over the bread and the cup. Basically, a whole panoply of the salvation history preceding is brought to bear in those few short remarks by Jesus, quite deliberately. And here we see another clear evidence of an intertextual echo, where in the end we wind up with 8 points of correspondence in a short section of text. So, in other words, this is a clear case where Paul is echoing a text in the Old Testament, in this case, Genesis 1:26 and 1:27. Now, I take it that this is convincing because I have debated in the past New Testament scholars who have started with the premise that Paul is not at all thinking of the creation text when he's indicting homosexual practice in Romans 1. And then I put this chart up, and then when the rebuttal period time comes, I never hear a rebuttal of the point. So I presume the reason for that is there is no rebuttal. I mean, once you have 8 points of correspondence in a short compass of text, case closed. If this isn't a case of intertextuality, of allusion, creating an echo chamber of meaning of allusions into an Old Testament text in the New Testament, then there is no intertextuality in Scripture, which would be an absurd point, right? Normally, with intertextuality, you're getting 2 or 3 points of correspondence in a short section of text, not 8. Now, what's the point of these echoes then? Idolatry and same-sex intercourse together constitute a frontal assault on the work of the Creator in nature. Okay? Jenny was talking earlier about contraception in this connection. It's basically a denial of natural body processes that God has given women. In a larger sense, the issue of same-sex intercourse is a denial in a holistic sense of the way in which God is made male and female. And it's basically going to say we just simply disregard the way we made. This is why it's moving in the direction of Gnosticism. It's sort of an antibody dualism, if you will. It's a denial of the Creator, ultimately. right? And just in case there's any confusion on this point, we do not want to be Gnostics, okay? I'm not promoting Gnosticism here, but making that's a bad one, okay? Instead of recognizing that as human beings recognizing their creation in God's image and their dominion over the animal kingdom, they began worshiping statues in the image of humans and animals, entirely inverting what God had intended. And instead of acknowledging that God had made them male and female, they ignored the obvious complementary features of male and female, and some even began having sex with members of the same sex. In short, those who had suppressed the truth about God in creation went on to suppress the truth about themselves, manifested in nature. Okay, that's Paul's argument. I can see this is an argument from Scripture. It doesn't matter how well or badly homosexual practice is conducted, Paul is in effect saying, in the ancient world. Homosexual practice is wrong in the first instance because it doesn't reflect the will of God manifested in creation and clearly enunciated in the direct revelation of Scripture from the very first chapters. I mean, so even if you're not inclined to read much of Scripture, if you just start at the beginning, right, just read the first few pages, you should get this point pretty clearly, right? And then, you know, if you want to stop reading after three pages, all right, you at least got this point. But even that point is not being accepted. Right at the get-go of the direct revelation, there is a rejection of God's will as creator. So it's hardly surprising that the whole rest of it will eventually be rejected. Maybe not overtly, but implicitly. That's why this is such an important issue. You start by rejecting the very beginning of the direct revelation, you're not going to be in a good place that you need to be in. Now, as you can note, although what we just said, I can hardly believe it. Come on, what kind of time system are we talking about here? We have special time operating in San Diego? Okay, I can't believe it here. It's not the time I operate with in Pittsburgh. I don't know what's going on. As you can see, this is also effectively an argument from nature because the word direct revelation about God's work in creation is also, in effect, an argument about nature. And that is that the truth about God is visible or apparent in material creation. That is, the knowable aspect of God is visible or apparent to them, he says in Romans 1, 19 to 20, because God has made it visible or apparent to them. Same Greek word means both visible and apparent. Ever since the creation of the world, his invisible qualities are clearly seen, being mentally apprehended by means of the things made. Now, I know if those of you who are Catholic here are going to have no problem with natural theology, but Presbyterians out of the circle that I come out of do. And what's interesting here is when John Calvin, who can hardly be thought of as anti-Presbyterian or anti-Reformed, when John Calvin looks at this text in Romans 1, he says, oh yeah, this is natural theology. Right? This is pretty obvious. Now, you can't know enough from natural theology to be saved, Calvin says. For that, you need the direct revelation of the gospel about what Christ has done on your behalf. But you can know enough from natural theology to be condemned. That is, to be held culpable for the sin that you commit. You are without excuse, without apology, without defense. Likewise, the truth about God. Now, here's the connection. A special connection between the idolatry presented first and then the issue of same-sex intercourse singled out among sexually immoral offenses. He could have put any form of porneia in there. He directed himself to the issue of homosexual practice because this is a classic example of the suppression of the truth about God accessible in nature, which is visible, obviously, in our gendered bodies. And it's visible at every level. And I mean visible in the broad sense I'm taking it. Anatomically, I hope I don't have to elaborate here on why that's obvious. Okay, anatomically, it's obvious that a man and a woman are each other's sexual counterpart. Physiologically, it's obvious in terms of procreation. You're utterly incapable structurally in your embodied existence of procreating as a male and a male and a female and female. It's not a question of equipment failure at any point. You just don't even have the equipment, period, in order to carry it out from the very beginning. And even psychology, right? How many men are getting therapy for the fact that his wife doesn't share her innermost feelings with him often enough? I'm sure somewhere it's happening, right? But normally, it's women who are complaining, the wives who are complaining. The husbands have to go a little bit deeper than an occasional grunt and, you know, and thank you very much for the meal. Let's have a little deeper conversation here. I'm exaggerating only just slightly here. Men and women are different, right? This is why people make money off men are from Mars and women are from Venus, because we laugh about it and it creates a lot of hilarities, but it is true that men and women are different, and they're different in ways that are complementary to each other. That is, the extremes of a given sex become moderated in the relationship of a man and a woman, and the gaps in the sexual self become filled, okay? In other words, pagans don't have to have the book of Genesis and Leviticus in front of them to know that this is inappropriate behavior. Now, someone could retort that, well, if you have a natural same-sex attraction, then that's natural for you to engage in it. Well, that is not what Paul means by natural, nor what anyone else in the ancient world means by natural. By natural, they mean formal, structural, embodied existences of persons. You can have innate desires to do things that are contrary to the way you have been structured in your body, right? Sin impacting the world especially affects our desires. If you cannot think of a half dozen desires that you have that are desires to do what God expressly forbids, then you need to be a little bit more self-reflective, because I can think of them immediately off the top of my head. We're just loaded up with desires to do what God doesn't want us to do, right? There's pride, there's greed, there's jealousy. Those are three to start us off here, and then you can just carry on beyond that point. Lust of various sorts that you shouldn't be having, and so on. We are just loaded up with innate desires to do what God doesn't want us to do. That doesn't mean it's natural for us to engage in it, because to engage in carrying out such impulses ultimately ends up being self-destructive. Okay? You can now. My wife worked for 10 years in the prison systems of Massachusetts. We dated for a number. By the way, that woman I talked to you about before, that's the woman I married, from met first in junior high and through high school and so forth. That's eventually the person that I married. But we broke up for like 4 years. Can you imagine she broke up with me? That's astounding. It's just, who could have thought that? But then we met again after 4 years through a series of providential circumstances, and I, lo and behold, I find out my Carol is actually working in a maximum security male prison counseling sex offenders. How does this happen? You know, well, they make Jamaican women tough, as I told you. I mean, they just, you know, don't worry about them. They'll get along pretty well, thank you. And she counseled a lot of pedophiles. And they were under no illusions that they were going to change, or let's put it this way, eliminate those desires. What they were working towards mainly was management of those impulses. Now, does that mean because though they have these desires, they didn't ask to have these desires, they can't get rid of these desires, or at least fundamentally affect them, that that is natural for them to engage in sex with a child? Obviously not. A child developmentally has not reached a point where it's appropriate for that child to be having sex, either physically or mentally. So it's by necessity an unnatural form of practice, because the embodied existences and structures supplied to that individual haven't reached the appropriate point of maturation. Doesn't matter what innate urge somebody experiences, that doesn't make it natural. The absence of a gender complement is the real issue for Paul. That's why he talks about same-sex intercourse being unnatural. And as we've just noted, its innate desires are very unreliable guides as to what God's will is for us. Now, another element in this, so we've covered now scripture and we've covered nature. Another element that indicates to us an absolute indictment is the indictment of lesbianism in Romans 1:26. Now, some will argue that lesbianism is not, in fact, being indicted. The reason why they argue that is because they know what the implications of the acknowledgement that he is indicting lesbianism makes. Namely, that Paul would be indicting all forms of homosexual practice, including committed forms, because lesbianism in antiquity is not typically conducted in the context of sex with an adolescent or a slave or a prostitute. So when lesbianism is being indicted, it's going to include committed relationships. And in order to avert that conclusion, not because the text moves them in that direction, but because they don't want that conclusion to arise, they will then argue that the text, when it refers to the natural use, the woman exchanges the natural use, but doesn't say of what. That they say what really is being referred to there is an unnatural form of heterosexual intercourse, whether that be anal intercourse or sex during menstruation or whatever it might be. Now, that just this problem with that is it just doesn't work from every single level of historical and literary critical evidence that you can bring to bear, but otherwise than that, it's a fine answer. And for example, likewise also, starts in Romans 1:27, and 1:27 refers to the natural use of the female, the male's natural use of the female. And that means you would expect the natural use of to be filled out with the opposite sex on the context. Moreover, lesbian intercourse is the form of female intercourse that's most frequently referred to as contrary to nature in Greco-Roman texts. It is also that form of female intercourse that is most commonly paired with male homosexual practice when the latter is discussed. So this would be the assumption, is that given that fact that Paul is talking about male homosexual practice in the next verse, given the fact that it refers to this female intercourse as unnatural, you would expect him to be talking about lesbianism based on Greco-Roman texts generally. Moreover, there's no doubt that Paul would be opposed to lesbianism because in the ancient world, in the Greco-Roman world, even among proponents of man-male love, there's basic opposition to lesbianism. So the idea that Paul could have held some secret acceptance of that in view of the fact that virtually no Greco-Roman moralist did is just historically untenable. Lesbianism is also the dominant patristic interpretation of Romans 1:26, right up to the time of Augustine. Then Augustine gives it a different spin, but that's because Augustine is looking for a text which indicates don't have too much pleasure in sex and marriage, for which he gets no support in the New Testament, and he picks this one. But normally Augustine is sure-footed. In this particular case, he's not. And all the interpreters prior to him do understand this as lesbianism. Moreover, lesbian intercourse is usually the clinching argument. We actually have debates in the ancient world between proponents of man-male love and proponents of male-female love. And in those debates, a sort of a clinching argument, the proponents of male-female love say, look, if you're going to continue to support man-male love, same-sex intercourse, to be consistent, you have to support lesbianism. We know you don't want to do that. Therefore, you lose. Okay? And so Paul's a lead-off argument in Romans 1:26 starts with an argument that it can count on as being beyond rebuttal. Quite natural in the context. Now, again, the importance of all this is to underscore, since he is, now, I believe we have established this, since he is indicting lesbianism, and since lesbianism in antiquity is not typically exploitative, therefore, Paul's not limiting his indictment to exploitative practices. Okay, that's the third argument. Fourth argument is that, by the way, pictures, you're seeing pictures up here of relatively equal age pairings. The notion that they didn't know about equal-age pairings of same-sex relationships in antiquity is simply false. Sometimes a picture is worth 1,000 words. And when you see the two persons looking into each other's eyes, it's an iconographic representation of mutuality and reciprocity. It's not merely that someone is having something done to them, but it's mutual and reciprocal. Okay? Paul himself emphasizes in the context mutual gratification. Males inflamed with their yearning for one another. Males with males. He's not talking about somebody doing it to you, coercing you, and you don't want to do it. They're inflamed with their yearning for one another. And the fifth argument here, by the way, this picture, you see two men with beards. Clearly none of them is an adolescent. And yet the inscription says, Ha pais kalos, the boy is beautiful. Well, they're using boy for the more passive receptive partner in the relationship, not for somebody who is actual boy in terms that we would think of. Did they know about carrying committed homosexual relationships in the ancient world? Short answer, yes. We can start with Plato's Symposium as an example of that. Aristophanes, the comic, makes a remark. They, the two men, continue with one another throughout life, desiring to join together and to be fused into a single entity, and to become one person from two. He's already given a sort of myth of creation in which human beings are created as three types of binary beings, male-male, a male-female, and a female-female. God gets angry at them, splits each of them in half. Thereafter, the one you most emanate from determines your sexual orientation. That's Aristophanes' presentation even before he makes this point. Sorry, I forgot to put that up there. And then it continues, Pausanias, who's also at the banquet, and is a lover of Agathon. This is a relationship that began not when Agathon was a boy, but when he was 18 years old, now 31. Pausanias says in the same context that love is neither right nor wrong in itself. I feel like I'm debating with somebody today. And for the right reasons, that lovers who love rightly are prepared to love in the expectation that they will be with them all their lives and will share their lives in common, as if having been fused into a single entity with the soul of the beloved. Does that sound exploitative to you? Doesn't sound exploitative to me. Sounds like a conception of caring, committed homosexual relationships. We don't have time to do the rest here, but these would be other examples that I would cite. Second century romances, Martial and Juvenal report about semi-official marriages between men in Rome. Lucian of Samosata reports about lesbian women who have the financial wherewithal to do pretty much whatever they want, increasing liberation's movement in this period of time. We have astrologers noting about women being born under a certain constellation who desire other women and marry them, as true also for men. We have rabbinic texts that forbid marriage between men, and one that even forbids marriage between women. And church fathers, including Clement of Alexandria, knowing about marriages between women in Alexandria, Egypt, and yet still calling them contrary to nature. Obviously, if they're getting married, they intend the relationship to be committed, caring, and loving, right? So if the rabbis and the church fathers are indicting even those relationships, then obviously they don't see any exception. Contrary to nature is an argument that transcends the question of the degree to which a relationship is caring or committed. That is irrelevant. First, the question has to be decided whether it is natural or not. All right, time is basically up, so that might look offensive to you, but just let me quote this from Thomas K. Hubbard. Don't worry about this cup if you go to the British Museum. I was at the British Museum about 7 or 8 years ago when I was invited to speak in London. I had one day off to go to the British Museum. I arrived, it was like a kid in a candy store. I can't believe how much the British have stolen over the years. It's just all there in the British Museum. You can see the Rosetta Stone and the Mona Lisa the moment I walked in. Those are the first two things I saw. Like, I'm overstimulated, you know? I got to relax. I got to calm down here. Think pleasant, peaceful nature thoughts for a moment. Anyway, I'm running from room to room in the museum seeing all these great artifacts from all different civilizations, including, I have to recommend most of all, the panels of the Assyrians had of their invasion of Israel, of the Northern Kingdom. I mean, right from that period of time in the 8th century, it's stunning all across the room. Like, I can't believe I'm here seeing the actual original here. Anyway, this Warren cup here, there are very few iconographic images of same-sex male intercourse in the Roman period for whatever reason. This is one of them, and though it may look offensive, what I found out when I went to the gift shop of the British Museum, there's like about 100 different cups, replicas of this, that you can buy in the gift shop of the museum. Needless to say, I did not buy one and bring one home for our coffee table. Anyway, Thomas K. Hubbard, who is a classicist from the University of Texas, Austin, and has written a premier source book of texts dealing with homosexuality in Greece and Rome. Hubble says that the first two centuries, quote, bear witness to an increasing polarization of attitudes toward homosexual activity. So now we do get some Greco-Roman moralists in this period who are actually opposed, while some are absolutely gaga over it, ranging from severe moral condemnation of all homosexual acts, no exceptions, actually ranging from frank acknowledgement to severe condemnation. And basic to the heterosexual position is the characteristic Stoic appeal to nature, which has matched and fitted the sexes to each other. So in other words, there's a very clear nature argument already existing in Stoic arguments about anatomical complementarity between male and female, and this being an obvious reason. Now, essentially what people are arguing, even though we have Greco-Roman moralists who say that we're opposed to all forms of homosexual practice. Not all of them do, but some do. Some scholars still want to argue, very few scholars actually now, but mostly church leaders want to argue in mainline Protestant churches that somehow, despite that fact, Paul, however, would not have been opposed to all forms of homosexual practice because he only came from a culture that was more strongly and unremittingly opposed to homosexual practice than anything else we know of in the world. Now, if that makes sense to you, then go with that. But it makes no sense. Why would somebody operating out of a cultural milieu even more strongly opposed to anything we know in the ancient Near East or the Greco-Roman Mediterranean basin, why would he have some secret acceptance of committed homosexual relationships when even Greco-Roman moralists, some of them, do not? Doesn't make any sense whatsoever. Okay? Yes, so your questions and comments, please. Thank you. Good time.
Just been listening to Dr. Robert Gagnon's talk, Paul and Homosexual Practice, at this year's student conference, It Takes a Family to Raise a Village. For the Q&A session afterward, check out the next podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Robeck Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.libsyn.com and iTunes. And as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love.